Hey guys, in this video we are going over the female reproductive system. We're going to go ahead and start with a little bit of orientation. We're going to have the anterior view, which includes the pubic symphysis, the round ligament. We're going to have the superior view, which is going to include the ovary and some vessels. We're going to have the posterior view, which is going to include the segment colon. The uterus is going to be kind of a posterior superior view, and then we're going to have the rectum, and we're going to have some of the vulva or exterior portions, and the vagina as the inferior view. So let's go ahead and focus on the anterior superior structures. So we're going to go ahead and have the hypogastric artery, just to kind of orient ourselves to where we are. We're going to have the iliac artery and vein, and now we're going to kind of focus on the ovary. So the ovary is going to be this white structure through here. We're going to have the fimbriae sitting on top of it, kind of like a glove, and the fimbriae are the finger-like projections that are going to catch the egg as it is secreted, or sorry, the oocyte as it's secreted. So the ovary, let's go back to that. We're going to have they are the femoral gonads, which means the opposite of the testes, right, for males. They're going to produce gametes, and they're going to produce the hormones such as progesterone and the estrogens for development. Next, the fimbriae. Again, as I said, they are the finger-like projections, which are going to be these right through here. Finger-like projections. They're number 3 on this model. The ovary was number 1. And these help catch the eggs as they're released so that they can go into the uterine tube. So, by the way, the uterine tube. You may have heard of it as the fallopian tube, the oviduct. There's a lot of names for it, but it's going to be the uterine tube in this video. And there's something called the ampulla, and this is going to be the widest and longest portion of the uterine tube. It actually takes out about 2/3 of the total 10 centimeter length. There's something called the infundibulum, which is kind of hard to say, but it's going to be this portion here between the ampulla and the fimbriae. And it's kind of like a funnel. It's going to help that egg that's been caught by the fimbriae get further into the uterine tube. So we're going to go a little more posteriorly now. Well, a little posterior superior. We're going to talk about the uterus itself. And so the uterus itself, you're going to see this number 8. That's actually going to be the fundus. So it's this dome-shaped portion. We're going to have the body or corpus. And then we're going to have the cervix, which is going to be this inferior portion of the uterus itself. And so the uterus, what is it? It's going to be the site of fertilized egg implantation, as well as the site of fetal development, right? As the fertilized egg grows and develops into a human, it's going to be growing inside this structure. So let's go a little further into the three major sections of the uterus itself. So we're going to have the perimetrium, which is going to be this external portion, and it's part of the visceral peritoneum that becomes the broad ligament as we go further out from the actual uterus itself. We're going to have the myometrium, which is going to be the muscular portion. It's the smooth muscle that's inside this portion here that's going to do contracting during labor. It's trying to help push the baby out. Then we're going to have the endometrium. So the endometrium is kind of, so you may have heard of endometriosis, which is going to be a disease affecting the endometrial layer. But so the endometrium is going to be this thinner inner portion that actually lines the uterine cavity. And by the way, this is going to be the uterine cavity. And so the endometrium, it's made up of 3 components, which basically is included in the 2 layers. So we'll go over the layers. The layers, you're going to have the functional layer, which is what produces the endometrial cells. That sloshes off during monthly menstruation when there is no implantation of a fertilized egg. Next, you're going to have the basal layer. You may have heard of it as the stratum basal. And this is going to be, this layer helps regrow the functional cells, which are those endometrial cells. So let's go into some other structures of the uterus. We're going to have the internal os, as you may have heard. And so, real quick. We just discussed that this is the uterine cavity. We're going to have the cervical canal, which leads to the cervix, which is going to be this little bump right here. So the internal os is going to be that opening from the cervical canal into the uterine cavity. So that's going to be the internal os. Then we're going to have the external os, which is going to be the opening from the end of the cervical canal into the actual vaginal canal. So going back to the cervix, we know that the cervix, this is where the mucus is going to be produced, and this helps, it thins out when there wants to be sperm cells to travel through, but obviously during stages of pregnancy, it's going to thicken up to prevent further sperm cell travel. So next, we're going to continue to go further inferiorly. So we're going to have the vagina itself. So this is when the baby during birth will actually leave out. And then we're going to have the vaginal opening. This during intercourse and during childbirth is entry and exit of the baby and the penis itself. We're going to have, so also, a lot of people are kind of confused about this, but unlike the male reproductive system, urine actually has a separate path. So we could see the bladder right through here. We see the urethra. So 22 is the urethra, 23 is going to be the urethral opening. But urine is leaves the body through its own separate tube. It does not share the vaginal canal, which is something that's kind of common people assume. Next, we're going to go even more inferior, and we're going to talk about some of the external structures. So the vulva itself is going to include the pubic mons, which is just going to be adipose tissue that covers the external, right here actually, pubic mons right here. It's going to include the labia minora and majora, which are going to be responsible. So the minora is going to be responsible for antimicrobial secretions that helps minimize any kind of microbe getting further into the vaginal tract. And the majora is going to have a lot of sebaceous glands, oil glands, sweat glands. Duty-wise, it's very similar to the scrotum in of itself, that they're just kind of a supportive structure that's there. They don't really have any major hormone production when it comes to fetal development. And also, we're going to have the vestibular glands, the vestibule. So inside here, since we're dealing at a cross-section, we're not really able to see them. But the vestibular glands, they're responsible for a lot of moisture secretions for intercourse and just for daily, I guess I would say, vaginal cleaning.